Okay, am I on? Am I mic'd up? I'm all jazzed up?
You're all jazzed up.
Well, it's great to see everybody. How many people were here on Sunday? I'm not taking attendance. I'm just kind of curious, maybe half the group. So what I want to do, I'm just going to go back into to Matthew, set the stage. I'm going to go back to Matthew 15 and read from verses 32. My mouth is too big. 32 and 39, and then just kind of open up and talk about the message and get some questions and stimulate some conversation, and then we'll kind of walk through it again as we did on Sunday, a couple verses by a couple verses. So we are in the book of Matthew. Again, in Matthew 14, Jesus had just fed 5,000, miracle, and now he's back in 15 doing the same thing. So Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion for these people. They have been with me for 3 days and had nothing to eat. I don't want to send them away hungry, or they may collapse on the way. His disciples answered, where could we get enough bread in this remote place to feed such a crowd? How many loaves do we have? Jesus asked. Seven, they replied, and a few small fishes. He told the crowd to sit down on the ground. Then he took the seven loaves and fish, and when they had given thanks, he broke them and gave thanks to them to the disciples, and in turn to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. Afterward, the disciples picked up seven basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate were 4,000, besides the women and children. After Jesus had sent the crowd away, he got into the boat and went to the vicinity of Megiddon. Amen. So, what was the theme of the message on Sunday in one word? Multiplication. Amen. The Lord multiplies when we give it away. So when we go back to that, I mean, what thoughts or what questions, you know, just anything that comes to mind from Sunday as we walk through from the beginning to the end, the call to action. Anybody? I'm sorry? What caught your attention, or what questions do you have from the message on Sunday? What caught your attention in this scripture? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The story that you're referencing was the pastor who their church was struggling, and they were upside down, and he had the opportunity to do guest preaching at another church and was given $7,000. And at first, like me, it's like, wow, I got $7,000. My debt is paid. I'm all good. And then the Lord said, give it away. And he argued with the Lord a few times, but then he decided to give it away. And it multiplied to $70,000 in return from the guy who was at the pizza restaurant, right? When we give it away, it multiplies. Yeah, when we give it away. Because we think, I'll speak for me, but I can probably speak, it's all about me. At the end of the day, I get lost. It's all about me, taking care of me. But when you give it away, the Lord always rewards us. You know, when we're obedient, he promises rewards in our life. What else? Right.
So many times in the past, you would see the people kind of falter in their faith or their hope and start, you know, for example, they're following Moses. They said, where are we going? I'm hungry. So they stop. Is there any sign of food? But is there, you see the difference in faith.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. They did. They had 3 days. 3 days. And they were just focused on the word. Yeah. Right. Yeah, and in Matthew 14, he had just done it. And they still had little faith. He had just shown the same miracle, you know, a little while earlier. Anybody? Anybody have little faith? Anybody ever have the Lord, you know, bless you and give you a new job, give you a miracle, give you something, and a week later, you're like, well, how am I going to do this? Come on, give me some examples, somebody.
Well, I'll just share a testimony.
Yeah, please.
I was at a service in Atlanta when I was living in Atlanta, and they were taking up an offering. And, you know, the pastor said, God doesn't want your tips. And all I had was $5. And I was fighting in my flesh. When he said that, I was not going to give it. But I pushed past my flesh, gave that $5, a lady.
Oh, really? Wow. Wow. Come on, let's get some more stories on that. Come on. I know that a lot of you have experienced little faith and then the Lord provided. Come on, somebody else. Yep.
You can do more with it than I can.
Yeah. Got a bigger opportunity. Yeah. Amen. Anybody else? I mean, I can share another story from Crossroads. One day, there was a guy standing next to this big fan, you know, those big 4 or 5 foot tall fans, and he was just bawling. He was just crying his eyes out. And I said, you know, what's your name and what's up? He said, I'm in big trouble. I got busted for violence, drugs, alcohol, did some time, got out. I was on probation. Then I tested hot, so then I went back in. And, you know, it's going to be bad. It is not going to turn out well for me. I'll probably have 5, 10, 15 years out of what had happened. And I looked at him, and he was pretty upset. And I said, well, there's a solution. And he looked at me and said, well, what? How are you going to get me out of trouble? I said, well, all I can offer you is Jesus Christ. I can offer you church, Bible study, and celebrate recovery. And, you know, I would invite you to come because the Lord will navigate you through. He's a way maker when there is no way. Amen? And Mitch looked at me and he said, well, I guess. He said, I'm at the bottom. I don't know what else to do. I guess I could do that. So he showed up the next day at church, and he showed up at Bible study, showed up at Celebrate Recovery, and he just started pouring in real hard. If you don't know what Celebrate Recovery is, it's a 12-step program. Actually, Alcoholics Anonymous, the 12 steps, were really taken from the Bible, but then they were formed into a secular perspective because they didn't want to make it about the Lord, about Christianity, because then people wouldn't sign up. So they genericized it, if you will. Celebrate Recovery took it back to the 12 steps, which are biblical steps. So it's the 12 steps of AA, which is really the 12 steps of the Bible, to walk you through relieving yourself from any pain. Anybody? Got pain? Any bad habits? Anybody? any addictions, anything that you have that's not connecting, that's keeping you from the Lord, if you walk through these 12 steps, you can get rid of it. Greed, lying, alcohol, drugs, sex addictions, you name it, walking through these 12 biblical steps. So Mitch signed up. He said, yeah, I'm in, man. I'm going to come to church. I'm going to come to Bible study. He was the first guy there, the last guy to leave, and he just kept on coming to everything we had. And one day he was getting prepared to go into his probation officer and speak with them because they were going to sentence him the next week. They're going to finish it off. And he said, what should I say? What do I tell him? And I reached over and I said, well, you can tell him whatever you want, but I'd tell him about what the Lord's done in your life. I mean, you haven't been drinking, you haven't been smoking pot, you're peaceful, you're in a completely different place. And he said, yeah, but this is somebody from the world. And I said, yeah. It is, and God trumps the world. I mean, I'd just go tell him about the Lord. But you do what you want, Mitch. You do whatever you want. So he went in and came back a couple hours later, and he said, well, I told him all about Jesus Christ and what he's doing in my life and how I'm working the 12 steps, the biblical 12 steps. And he said, I don't know, though, because she's of the world, and I'm not sure how it's going to turn out. And I said, well, I don't know, but I'm going to put it in God's hands and have trust. So we prayed. The next week, he was going in for his sentencing, and we prayed. He packed all of his bags, and the director at the shelter, who had been there for like 20 years, knew a lot about his situation and others like that. And he said, yeah, he'll be gone for north of 10 years. It's not going to be a good day for him. So we prayed, and he went in, and a few hours later, came back. I went up to his room, and he was sitting on his bed. And I thought, huh, that's weird. And he had his arm around his son, and all of his bags were there, and he was bawling his eyes out. And I sat down next to him, and he said, I said, what's up? He said, grace. God's undeserved favor. And he pulled up his pant leg. He said, it's gone. My bracelet's gone. I'm no time, and I've got to go to an anger management class. Wow. Wow. Amen. Wow. Wow. Wait. It gets better. A wife and three kids all accepted the Lord within the next year. Amen. When we give it up, He will. When we are obedient to the Lord, He will bless us. Back to your point. You know, Mitch had little faith for a while, but yet he trusted in the Lord, got over it, and shared his story, shared his testimony. Anybody else, any stories on little faith and God's miracles in your life? Any witnessing? When we continue to walk through, first just starting on 29 through 31. Jesus left there and went along the Sea of Galilee. Then he went up on the mountainside and sat down. Great crowds came to him. Of course great crowds did. Bringing the lame, the blind, the crippled, mute, and many others. And they laid them at his feet. And he healed them. The people were amazed when they saw the mute speaking, the crippled made well, the lame walking, and the blind seeing. And they praised the God of Israel. In this scripture and in many other areas, I find it fascinating that he'll heal, he'll feed, he'll take care of our earthly needs, but what does he really want? What type of nourishment does he really want to give us? Spiritual nourishment, right? I mean, we've got a food bank, and we've got people going to Colfax, and we do things physically for people, give them food and all of that, but at the end of the day, our hope, our desire deep down inside is that we can share the good news with them. Because then no matter what our circumstance in life, we can have peace and joy. We can have hope. We can have hope in our lives. I mean, when I go back to Crossroads, I don't want this all to be about Crossroads, but one of the biggest things that we gave through church and Bible study was hope. Because they were hopeless. no home, no food, an addiction, and hope is so important in our lives. And that's what the Lord provides for each and every one of us every day. I mean, when we're up, it's pretty good, but when we're down, we certainly need that hope. Amen? Amen? So, when you look at that, those couple verses, you know, for you, what do you view your life in discipleship? Because we've all been given the Great Commission, right, to go forth. We've all been given it. We're all different. We're going to get to that in a second, because we're all unique. We're all diverse. We all have different talents. But how do you envision your role in discipleship in this world? Please. Pay it. Yeah. Pay attention to what's going on. You raise your hand. No, I'm counting that. You scratch your ear. I'm counting that as a hand raise. Right? Right? How do you view your role as a disciple?
Paying attention or just being present is what happened when Christ had compassion, because they missed it and he caught it through his compassion that they needed to be fed.
Right.
So being present or paying attention is really important to being who you're supposed to be in the moment,
yeah.
Whatever that moment is.
Yeah. Because, I mean, we go to work, we have our days, and we can just go through and focus on our tasks. But when we pay attention to others, things that are around us, it's really enlightening. And we have opportunities all the time to bless people, to pray with people, to listen, just be present, right? A lot of times people just want us to be present, know that they're loved, and hear whatever's going on. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Has the Lord ever asked you to do something? It's been pretty clear. And you're like, oh no, I'm too busy. Or that's going to embarrass me. If I go pray with Annette, that's going to, no, I can't do that. Anybody? Right? He speaks, you hear him, and you walk the other way. I mean, I hope we all get in the habit of once he speaks, we stop and go, no, I'm not taking three, I'm stopping on three steps, I'm turning around, I can repent for my sin right now and go back and pray for that person or ask them how they're doing or whatever. Because so many times, it's right in front of us. We just have to open our eyes and we'll see it, because there are opportunities everywhere. Now you fix your glasses, I'm going to call on you again, man. Keep your hands in your pocket. continuing in verse 32, Jesus called his disciples to him. I have compassion for these people. They have already been 3 days, and this is what you were mentioning, and had nothing to eat. I don't want to send them away hungry, or they might collapse on the way. And we kind of spoke about that with the spiritual nourishment. In verse 33, he says, his disciples answered, where could we get enough bread in this remote place to feed such a crowd? How many loaves do we have? Jesus asked. Seven, they replied, and a few small fish. And then in the message, what I jumped to at that point was, how many of you feel like you're not enough? Come on, everybody get your hands up, right? We always, exactly, we feel like we're not enough. And we're not, but with him, we're more than enough. We're more than enough. I mean, on my own, 5'10", 150 pounds, what am I? A Packer fan, right? That's even worse. My stock is plummeting, isn't it? But through Christ, when we live in Him, miracles can happen. And we are all gifted. Again, we're diverse, right? Male, female, black, white, with hair, without hair, tall, small. We're all different because He made us that way. And He did that for a reason. And we're all gifted in different ways. And the ones that I identified, brought forward the other day were from Contagious Christian. So when we look at discipleship or we look at evangelizing, and I'll set the stage and then talk about the six, again, we can walk through life thinking it's all about me, because that's what Americans do, right? We're the great consumer, aren't we? We consume and collect and material items, and you know, we have to look good, and it's all about us. Versus He tells us to give it away, to disciple, to evangelize, to share the good news. And when I say evangelism, you know, most people are like, well, I didn't memorize the Bible like Pastor Felix, so I can't do that, and I don't want to thump people with the Bible. That's not what evangelizing is. That is not what evangelizing is. I mean, if you know the Bible, you can share. You can, because one of the styles is intellectual. I mean, if you clearly, you know, have gone to school, to seminary, you've studied the Bible, you can teach, you're intellectual. That is one approach. And it's a very effective approach. Very, very effective approach. But then there's the approach that I spoke about with Peter in Acts 2, you know, where he's in Jerusalem back in the day, and he's there primarily with Jews in the day of Pentecost, and he's boldly telling them to repent from their sins and accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, as the Messiah. I mean, that was bold, and he was very direct. And on that day, one turned into 3,000. Can you imagine? 3,000 people coming to Christ, all because He chose to be bold. And we can all be bold at some level, but some of us are wired to be bold. I mean, I'm thinking of when you were preaching a couple, you're bold. You were up there and you were very, very bold. Amen? You get bold. I get bold. So some of us are gifted to be bold, and we need to just put it out there and say, accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Repent from your sin. Whatever the message might be. And some of us might be like Peter. We might be that bold to just go forward and say it and call it directly. Or testimonial. Again, I alluded to it, and I'll share a little bit more today, but testimony and storytelling is very, very powerful, right? Once I was blind, and now I can see. Well, how does that happen? I did it. No, I didn't do it. Right? The Lord did it. The Holy Spirit. I mean, I go back and look at my life. I mean, I grew up in a house where it was a great house. There's no complaints. Wonderful parents. Absolutely wonderful parents. But we had crazy dysfunction. I mean, my brother came back from Vietnam. I was 12. He committed suicide in our house. My dad served in World War II, frontline with Patton, shooting and killing people, hand-to-hand combat for 3 years. I don't know about you, but that will mess you up. He was a great dad, but a practicing alcoholic. And so who did he pass that on to? Well, one was me, right? When I was in college, I was on the Olympic drinking team, and I had all gold medals. I was a grand champion, right? I mean, I got straight A's, but you can shake your head. Exactly. And one day the Lord came to me in a dream. I was at a bottom. I was at a low point. He allowed me to get to a low point, kind of like the Dead Sea in the sermon. I was at a low point in my life, and He came into my dream and spoke all night long. I got up and wrote 5 pages, single space, of everything He said. He walked me through my entire life, called out all my sin patterns, told me to pick up my cross and come follow Him. I got up the next day, and I turned the opposite direction, never touched another drop of alcohol in my life, completely transformed through Christ. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Our stories are powerful. Our story, I mean, And we, you all have a story. You all have a story. You need to share your story. Because one day you came to Christ. I don't know what day that was. Maybe it was something like this, or maybe it was grandma. I don't know, but you have a story to tell. And it's an important story, because your story is his story. And so we all can be testimonial. For me, it's one of my best evangelizing or discipling talents, because he created quite a story in me. Or Ray, like I spoke about. I mean, Ray was a Vietnam vet. This was a couple years ago. Ray was in a wheelchair for a long time. Ray was in a wheelchair for decades. And then some pastor by the name of Scott prayed over Ray. And the next day he could, that's a story. That's a story to tell. When you're in a wheelchair for decades and one day somebody prays over you and you walk, you got to tell that story. You have to tell that story, because that is all the Lord. Amen? Yeah, in his glory. So we've got direct intellectual testimony, interpersonal, right? Our parking lot was boring on Sunday, right? Interpersonal, right? More than you, but there are a lot of interpersonal. Some people are just, they just exude love and caring and kindness no matter where they go. And some are gifted that way. You need to share that, the love of Christ. The Lord built that in many people. So when you have that ability to be interpersonal and share Christ's love and compassion with others, you need to be out there sharing that with other people. Invitational. You know, I know you're all already signed up for community groups and you're on a roll. And one of the things you're going to be challenged with is in every community group meeting, having at least three people on your list and inviting them. Because I promise you, you did not get up one day and just go, oh, nobody told me about church, but I'm going there. You were invited. I promise you, you just didn't make it up in your mind and just decide to go to church on a Sunday at 9 o'clock. Somebody told you about it. And if you don't tell somebody, you're selfish. I'm bold. If you don't tell somebody, if you don't invite them to church, that's selfish. We need to. So you'll be challenged to be thinking about people, family, friends, neighbors, whatever, and saying, hey, we have church. At first it may feel uncomfortable, but we all should be inviting people. We all should. Because if we don't, right? But at the end of the day, if everybody invited three people, and let's say our hit rate was really bad, we only got 10%, darn, you know, we'd have a few hundred people here, more than we have today. Salvation, baptism, wouldn't that be terrible? Less people left behind, right? I mean, you think about your family for a second. I'll take you back. Close your eyes. Think about family or friends, somebody dear to you in your life, and they do not know the Lord. They have not accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and the Jesus comes. It's a second coming tonight, and we are all gone, and they're left behind. How do you feel? How do you feel? I hope it hurts. Invite. What's the worst they can say? No. Right? And if you've got a style, share your testimony. Be interpersonal. Be intellectual. Use your gifting. Use your gifting to try to get people to consider coming to church and knowing the Lord. And last but not least, serving. You know, and I referenced Mother Teresa. I mean, just think about her for one moment. I mean, she's a little old lady. Little old lady. She had 4,500 sisters underneath her, serving hospice patients, homeless, broken. She had 4,500 disciples, discipling people in 133 countries. How is that for a ministry? I mean, when I was preparing for the message on Saturday morning, I thought of our outreach ministry. You know, Maya is involved in that, and she came to my mind when I was reading about the lame and the crippled and all of that. So I texted her, and lo and behold, as I was thinking of her and what they were doing in outreach, they were on Colfax with seven ladies, sharing the good news, giving food. Servants. I text her again today, and they've got a schedule every Sunday for the next month, and I'm going to try to get out there and go with them one of these weekends on a Saturday, because they go out and serve people with addictions. I mean, they went and met with some folks, and they heard multiple times people saying, addicts, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I wish you had a Celebrate Recovery program. We do. And it needs a start. Because it's not about me holding it and looking at the books going, I got great books. These are beautiful books on my shelf. Those books need to be off the shelf and shared. We need to be inviting those folks. And we're talking about that, getting Celebrate Recovery started soon. Because Celebrate Recovery, I'll tell you, works like Novocaine. All you've got to do is inject it, pull the trigger, and it works. You follow the 12 steps, and I don't care what your problem is, and y'all have one, unless you already walk on water, and there's only one. We all have something. Greed, vanity, drugs, alcohol, pot, I don't know. We all have something, and we can give it back. Because it was put on the cross 2,000 years ago. We just went, I went and took mine off. I'm like, I'm going to be an alcoholic for a while and see how that turns out. Doesn't turn out very well, does it? Go give it back. Put it back on the cross. He wanted it in the first place. Give it back. Give it back. So again, we're all called to share the good news. We are all called to. And think about, you do have giftings, and you probably kind of know what your giftings are, but do not be embarrassed, because the worst thing that can happen is somebody won't be inclined to come to church or whatever you may offer. But think about it and take those steps to advance the kingdom and leave no one behind. And then the last thing in the scripture that I want to mention, and just open up and Pastor Felix, if you have anything to say. Jesus sent away the crowd, and he got in the boat and went to the vicinity of Megadan. I'm sure we all do, but I just want to remind us that the power of prayer. I mean, our Father wants a relationship with us, and we need to go isolate sometimes. For me, it's best first thing in the morning and last thing at night for isolation. I pray unceasingly during the day. But that isolated time is real, because when you got noise going on, it's hard. But when you have that, when you go to that vicinity, to that quiet place, you can probably hear from him better. Because it's not just this about going and saying, you know, Lord, I want, right? It's praying and then listening to what he has to say. And that's why I always couple it with the Bible. Because a high percentage of the time, the Bible will speak to me for the Lord. The exact thing that I'm thinking about or needing in my life, he puts it right in front of me in the Bible. And it gives me guidance for what I'm needing to work on or think about. Excuse me. Questions, thoughts. And then I want to open it up to... Well, I'll just close with this. I pray for multiplication. I love multiplication. I don't know if I'm going to live a day or 100 years. I have no idea. But before I die, all I want to do is give all my energy to multiplying the kingdom. Because that's the only thing for me that matters. And I pray that we as a people, as a unified body in Christ, as a church, can be more and more about multiplication. Thank you.